Ciao tutti, bentornati o benvenuti a TM1 Nybble's Technology Information in under 16 minutes. Today's episode is about environment variables in Windows. Do you need to know about them if you're an average computer user? The truth is that most computer users will go through life without ever knowing that they're there, much less what they are. However, one is vital for TM1 administrators and some types of TM1 end users, and is useful for anyone else, especially if one of their programs won't run. Another, it is important for all Windows users to be aware of, and certainly for TM1 end users to know about. These will be covered in the next two episodes, and in this one, we are going to look at the general principles of environment variables. Your 16 minutes starts now. What are environment variables? Environment in this case refers to your computing environment, that is your machine, its hardware, the network that it's connected to, and so on. Most of all, they store information about file paths, that is the directories that hold important data for programs to use. Well-written computer programs do not assume the locations of these paths, but instead get them from environment variables. So what are variables? Programmers already know what variables are. For anyone else, they are simply named places in the computer memory which can store data. Now, this data can be numeric values, it can be text, which is also known as strings in computer speak, that is strings of characters, can be dates, can be objects like Excel workbooks, and so on and so forth. Environment variables are all strings, even if they represent numeric values like the number of processors that your computer has. The values that are stored can change over time, and hence they are known as variables. However, environment variables are less variable than regular variables are. Some, like the ones that describe your computer hardware, probably won't change over the entire life of the computer. Others will only change if you install a new program. Some can be added or deleted by you, the user. Some, as we shall see in later episodes where we talk about creating batch files, can exist for only one session. So the next question is, where does all of this data come from? Some values are evaluated by the computer when it starts, such as the information about the type of processor. Some are determined when the user logs in, since while some environment variables relate to the system as a whole, others only relate to the currently logged in user. A lot of it comes from the registry, which is a text-based database containing information about your computer. It stores vastly more information about the computer and its programs than you'll find in the environment variables. Generally, programs store the information that they need to start or run in the registry. And we'll talk more about the registry in future episodes, which introduce automation and programming. For now, if you hear the word registry, just think the computer's database about itself and all of its programs. Next question is, do all users see the same variables? Well, there are two main classes of environment variables. The first are system variables, and these apply to all users, and even to no users if the computer is running but nobody's logged into it. The second are user variables, which apply only to that specific user login. Now, in some cases, system variables and user variables will have the same name, as we shall see shortly, and by default the user one will be used. The most obvious one of this is the temp environment variable, which we'll see in a moment. You could argue that there is a third class which exists only while a single command window is running. We'll see those in a moment too. So the next question, of course, is where can I see these environment variables? Okay, the first place is through the GUI. If you are in Windows 7 or if you are using Classic Shell, as I am because I will not have that tiles garbage on my desktop, you can go to Start and then this PC, right click and select Properties. Now, if you are not using Classic Shell and you have that tiles garbage inflicted upon you, you can type, what the, soda, really, Mickey Mouse, oh good, what is this, Candy Crush Soda Saga, installed without my permission, thank you Microsoft, I shall get rid of that garbage later. But as I was saying, you can type this PC, and then you will be able to continue as normal, right click, select properties. Now once you select properties, you go to advanced system settings, and then you go to, I'll just drag this down so it's within the recording area, environment variables. The top pane will show you the local user environment variables, I should say. The lower pane will show you the system variables. So these are the ones that apply to everybody on the computer and nobody who's logged into the computer. These ones apply only to this particular login. Note the presence of temp and TMP. If we go down here, temp and TMP, and the destinations are different. So the system environment variables named temp and TMP are the ones that Windows itself will use. It'll put all of its garbage in C Windows temp, whereas mine will go into a directory that we shall talk about later on called the app data directory. If you're on Windows 7, you probably won't see OneDrive here and also this path environment variable which goes to Windows app, and that's because in version 7 OneDrive was not integrated into the operating system the way it is in Windows 10, and also there were thankfully no apps back in the Windows 7 day. The next place that we're going to look at is the command line. What is a command line? It's the old school way of interacting with an operating system. You used to have to configure, administer, and even run programs via a command line window. To get to one, we will go to the start menu, type in CMD. This should also work if you have those abominable tiles. You will see that there is the option to launch a program called CMD, which is of course short for command. That opens outside the recording area in my case, so I'll drag that down. Now I am going to change this window around a little bit so that you can see it more clearly. I shall go to properties and bump the font up to 24 points, should be enough. Okay, that's a little bit easier to read. Now from here you can do things such as creating new directories, moving files around, launching applications. Let's take a look at an example of that. Over here we have the logging files data directory, well, the logging files directory for the Scuderia Quantistica TM1 server. We want to open up a new folder called archives, so we can type the command MD for make directory. Then we specify the path, which is to logging files here. We say archive, which means that we are going to make a directory called archive on that path. Watch what happens over here as I press enter. Over here we now have the folder called archive. Commands such as these can be grouped together, or we should probably say batched together, into a single text file which is called a batch file, which can then be called as if it's a single command. Why do command lines even still matter if we have Windows? Because command lines and the batch files that you can create from them are useful and powerful when administering a computer system, even if it's just your own PC. In fact, this is the old style of command line. There is a newer one called PowerShell, with which you can administer literally dozens, even hundreds of computers on a network from a single PowerShell window, which you cannot do with a GUI. Command lines are not going away for power users and admins, and we'll be talking a lot more about them as time goes by. So what does this have to do with environment variables? Both batch files and single commands can use environment variables. Before we see how, let's take a look at the environment variables within the command window. To get to there, you type the command set, and thus all of the environment variables will be revealed. This list is more or less the same as the one that we saw in the GUI. There are a couple of differences relating to the fact that this is a command line, the GUI is a GUI. Other than that, they're pretty much identical, and certainly the values for any common environment variables are exactly the same between the two. Why is it set? Well, you use the set command to set a value for an individual environment variable. In reality, it's generally easier to create new environment variables or change their values in the GUI than it is in the command line, but it is perfectly possible to do it in the command line. We can also see the value of an individual environment variable in the command line by just typing set followed by its name. So if we want to see the value for the temp directory, for example, we can type set temp, and there it is. Note well that this is the user environment variable that comes up, so it's the one that is specific to this particular login. Now, as I said, environment variables can be used in either single commands or in batch files. Let's see an example of that. So in this case, I'm going to type cls just to clear the screen. In this case, I'm going to move the file AAA, lots of A's, move this file into the temp directory. I've only got the lots of A's simply to keep the file at the top of the list, so you can see that over there. I actually have the temp directory opened in another window, so we should see it coming up here somewhere. You'll note that I have put percentage signs around temp. Why is that? This is the symbol that you use to expand an environment variable, and by expand I mean you take the name of the environment variable and you convert it into what is stored within that environment variable, which in this case will be the temp directory that is specified in that environment variable. So observe what happens when I hit enter. One file moved, moves out of there, and you will see it now down here. We will see where else these expansion symbols can be useful in a very short space of time. Now, while I did say that it is easier to create a permanent environment variable using the GUI, you will often need to, if you are doing batch programming or if you're using command line window, you may need to create your own temporary environment variables, and that is really easy to do. You type set to begin with, obviously. You type the name that you want to use for your temporary environment variable, you type equals, and then you type what its value is. Remember that even if this is a numeric value, it's going to be treated as text, and it is important that there be no spaces between the variable name, the equals sign, and the value. So if I press enter there, we can now use the echo command to expand that out, my var, percentage sign, and the echo command simply returns to the screen whatever the value is that you've entered. So in this case, it is expanding out what my var is and returning the value that we have assigned to it. You can then use that in a command. So over here, get the directory listing for the log files path that we've seen before using my var. So we're doing a search for the pattern of all files that start with TM1, S2, and then whatever follows. So that's just basically a wildcard search. That should return all of the old log files from the server. So if we press enter here, there we have it. Now, one thing to note about temporary environment variables, they exist only for the purposes of that particular session. So if I go over here to a separate window, and I type echo my var, press enter, it'll just return my var in percentage signs because it has no idea that this is actually a variable name. That variable only exists within that one window, or in the case of a batch file, only within that one batch file. Now, just to finish up in the command line for the moment, there will be more on this in future episodes, there are a couple of minor environment variables which you will not see in the set list and you will not see in the GUI either, but you can get to them in batch files and command lines, and they are ones like date and time, ones which are dynamically allocated a value. So if I type echo and then expand date and expand time, both of which are environment variables as well, then I get the date and time. You can in fact pass the information out of those to extract them, such as by this method. I'm not going to go into the syntax of this. This is a subject for a separate video on command line programming and on batch files, but just to give you an example, you can see there it has extracted the hour out of the time environment variable, so 16:16. And finally, for this episode, we are going to look at creating a permanent environment variable. I have already opened up the graphical user interface since this is the easier way of doing it. It's not going to be a user variable, it's going to be a system variable, so it will be available to the system itself as well as anybody who is logged on this machine. You would probably need local administrator rights to be able to do this, but I shall show you the method for it anyway. It's exactly the same for creating a user variable, except that you would do it up here instead of down here. We are going to create a reference to the path to the Scuderia Quantistica TM1 database server, which is located at DTM1SQ for the moment, but that could change. And if it changes, we can change the environment variable and have any programs that refer to that location automatically redirect. So I'm going to go new. All I have to do is specify the variable name, so I'm just going to call it SQ. We're going to put in the variable value, which is the path to that particular directory. You can, of course, use the browse directory or browse file buttons. We don't need to do that in this case. Click on OK, and you will now see that down here we have SQ, OK, and OK. Now, what is the use of that, I hear you ask? Now, let's go back to PC. Remember how we expanded an environment variable by putting percentage signs around it? We can do exactly the same thing here. SQ percentage sign in the address bar of File Explorer or Windows Explorer, depending on which version of Windows you're on, enter, and we go directly to that location. But I hear you ask, why not just add it to the Quick Access group? And you can certainly do that, but there are a couple of issues there. First is that Quick Access can very rapidly become cluttered, and secondly, and more importantly, if you write a programming batch or a script, that is not going to know about your Quick Access groups. Here, you can use the environment variable to expand out to that location, and it doesn't matter whether it's your login or whether it's another login or whether it's a system login. All of them know exactly where that directory is now. In the next episode, we are going to be looking at one environment variable in particular, a vitally important one, the path environment variable. Not the user one, but the system one. It is an incredibly useful environment variable and one that you must know about if you are a TM1 administrator or one of a certain type of TM1 users. And indeed, it's incredibly useful even if you are neither of those. In the episode after that, we are going to be looking at another environment variable, but not just the variable itself, the underlying location of that variable, and that is app data, something that every computer user should know about. But for now, your time is done, so until the next episode, goodbye.